Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Unapologetic Queens Radio Show. I'm Tylea.
I'm Christina.
And yes, we're a little bit late right now, but better late than never.
You know, we always see pizza happening.
Today, and it's okay because we started at my birthday time. Blame work. I got caught up at work. Blame work. Blame work. That's really what it is. She knows. I was like on the journey. I went over the hills,
through the woods,
to grandma's house, then to Christina.
And then Eli.
So here
we are.
Indeed. And yeah, how was your week?
It's pretty good.
Since last Tuesday.
You know, we had that cool event on Saturday.
Real cool.
That was
real
cool. Super fun.
Super true.
Shout out to the Suited Lifestyle.
Yes, yeah, Suited Lifestyle.
Lawrence put that joint together.
Yeah.
He was.
I'm so proud of everything he's become. Like, I remember when he was a freshman. Now he's grown. H-E-15.
But yeah, it was a beautiful event. There was
I'm talking about he was a freshman. We was a freshman.
Right.
We were
exactly.
Freshmen.
I don't remember when
I just feel like he was so much. He acted young back then, so that makes sense because the fashion show on the yard was freshman year, and he was my partner. Okay. Yeah. Wow.
When life comes full circle. No, it's real though.
Like, together. Shout out to the lifestyle. Shout out to Society of Young Revolutionaries.
Shout out to Distinctly Creative and Covenant House for also partnering. It was really great. Everybody had it was like a Howard reunion, really.
It really was. And it was like a good, it was good vibes all around. Like, nobody was trying to be cool. Like, I wish that more younger people or current Howard students could have been here to see how Howard events really go.
Yes. Yes. That's retweet.
Like, that was the perfect example of the Howard events I was used to. Other people might have a different experience, but I know, like, everybody was rocking with everything. Like, at the end of the night, you remember, there was this dope rock band. I cannot remember their name.
Yes.
They were dope. I mean, like, dope. And, like, I feel like at HBCUs, people expect us to not bang with rock music, which is awkward because I'm like, y'all still don't understand that we created it. Whatever.
Right.
Because I did have this get someone together about that. They're like, oh, I guess this is not my style. Because they were like, oh, y'all really, he was like, black people really bump into this? And I was like, I mean, it wouldn't exist without us. And he was like, well, I guess this is not my style. Yeah, I guess not, bro. Boop.
Whatever.
Skirt.
Anyway, we're not a monolithic people, so.
Exactly. And like, the band was so good. My dad plays guitar. I literally took videos and sent them to him.
What did he say?
He was so impressed. He asked me the band's name. I couldn't remember, so I didn't respond. I was like,
I actually have one of those remember. Dudes' numbers in the band, so I could.
Yeah. I remember the. Yeah. That night was.
You know, the drinks were a flow.
They were a flowing. No, shout out to their Long Island iced tea.
Oh, yes. Yes, indeed. Because I ended up getting one. I was like, you know what?
Yeah, they were a little heavy handed with the.
Yeah. And, you know, like in Jersey, like LITs are not. Anything like they're probably like the cheapest drink, so I'm just like, yeah, let me get an LIT. Yeah. I'm like,
yeah, DC goes hard. I didn't know. So last weekend, Friday, my line sister Gavette celebrated her birthday. Shout out to Gavette, happy birthday! She's 26.
Yay.
I'm so proud. Like,
first of all, Gavette, she slays. Debate. I just that's the one thing
that really she says that every time I mention Gavette,
and she has my last name, so you know
that's true.
Shout out to you, Richardson. But she, I was in that audience like, she slayed, and I think we were against Harvard. We were against Harvard, and they're the real HU.
Never,
whatever. Mind you, they're at Harvard College. Everyone's asleep, but you know, I digress. But shout out to
Boop. Yeah, she's the one who put me on last week in all the Long Island I see. She's like, just get a Long Island.
Yeah, just take care of everything the whole night.
And I was like, and then Saturday taught me. Yes, it does.
Yes, indeed.
Everything the whole night. Twas proud.
And mind you, it was for a good cause. Like, we don't just turn up for no reason.
Yeah, you got to turn up with a purpose.
Yeah, like, it was for Covenant House, which is an organization that aids homeless people. And, you know, it was for homeless awareness. So, I mean, obviously we are very aware of the homeless living in D.C.
Yes.
But, you know, some people may be asleep.
Right.
And, you know, it was to raise money. It was also a clothing drive. Like, I believe the drinks were partially donated to Covenant House. Everyone brought in clothes to get in for, like, free entry. And we are making a donation to Covenant House as well as Society of Young Revolutionaries, you know. Philanthropic endeavors. Yeah, we try to do things. But, yeah, so it was great. Party with purpose.
Always.
Always.
So hashtag party with purpose.
You're always.
It was good. Well, it was awkward. I'm not gonna lie. Actually, now that I think about it, I was like, Tuesday. It's always interesting when we do our how was our week, because it's like from like Tuesday to Tuesday versus like on right. a Friday.
Yes.
Wednesday, you know, I was in a car accident, so that was annoying.
That was annoying.
She was on the phone pissed. She was like, she was going off. I can't say it on the radio, right, but just know that she was going off.
Yeah.
Know that she was going off. Sometimes we curse a little bit here and there, but like, no, I can't repeat what Christina was saying. She was pissed. I was pissed too. I was in one of those little car to goes. And yeah, that was annoying.
I'm just happy that she's alive, because I would have to kill someone. So, yay.
Yeah. But yeah, that was annoying. So I was achy last week. So I was just like, that was like my face last week. Ugh life. So I don't even know how I managed to go out on Saturday.
Right.
It wasn't, I guess because it wasn't super bad, but my back, like, and stuff was hurting. So Wednesday and Thursday, I was not at work. Thursday, I worked from home. I just stayed in bed all day. All day long. Like, Imani brought me my pizza and everything.
Oh,
yeah, like, she was like, she was like, here you go. Let me know if you need to go downstairs. Let me know. I was like, you're so loyal.
Oh.
And she brought me ibuprofen. But, yeah, so I'm just thankful for that. I was just like, wow, that could have been so much worse. Thank you, Jesus. Because car to go versus car-to-go? Van.
Yeah, like, no.
And another car. Yeah, because the van pushed my car and kind of was in between two cars. That's, like, a significant detail that I forgot about. But, yeah, that was really awkward. So, I'm very grateful that I am okay. Yeah. That actually prompted me to want to go out and celebrate for Gavette's birthday. That's what I did Friday, celebrate Gavette's birthday. Saturday, the event at Covenant House. Sunday, I was with Gavette again. Also, like, in her defense, she had been studying for the LSAT, and, like, she just took the LSAT.
Oh,
so
yes.
She, yeah, so she that was, she like, was gone. She
out.
Was gone. Okay. And I was so upset because I was with her all the time, and I was like, where's Gavette, y'all? And she's like, yeah, I've just been studying. I'm like, be great.
Right, and we, mind you, we always pass Gavette's house when we come here.
I know. She
she's
lives
like,
right
hi,
there.
Gavette.
I was like, hi, Gavette. I miss you. But, yeah. And then what? Oh, last night I was on a panel representing Sawyer. It was my Neos panel. I was really proud of them for May Week about financial literacy.
Yay.
And I was like, yay, go Sawyer, go Sawyer. It was just, it's always interesting being at Howard and not being an alum.
Or
and,
being an alum?
I mean, and being an alum. What am I talking about? And not being an alum. And being, so
not
you're a
student.
Being a student. Yeah, and not being a student, like, I was walking, especially because, you know, it was warm. It's warm now, so right. The yard is popping.
Right.
Versus when you walk
Ooh,
through Howard
yes.
to do something else, and it's, like, winter.
Right.
No one's out. Like, no one cares. At Black all. People, we don't do cold.
At all.
Anywhere.
Like, no.
We got plenty of people from Howard that are from Alaska, but we still don't do cold as a people.
Right. And no one is on the yard in the middle of the
Gone.
Winter. It's like,
Gone.
Shoop, and you go to class. You go
and
to
you
your
go
room.
To your room. Right. Or you go to whoever is inside,
right.
whatever is inside, but you're not just
not
chilling around.
Outside.
And so it was just crazy because I was, like, walking through. The way I, like, walked not across the yard, but I walked, like, down and over. And I was just like, I went to chapel brunch Sunday.
Oh, shoot. Okay. I haven't been to chapel in a hot minute.
Yeah, you're wilding. The speaker's
I'm out
really
here
good.
Working.
I know.
Oh, Sunday. I'm a heathen.
You're not a heathen. God knows. God knows. But, you know, one thing I want to talk about, something very interesting. So my job actually had an opening night, and it was a show about South Africa. So apartheid, reconciliation, whatever. So one of the gentlemen who's in one of the shows is very, very conscious, right? He plays Eugene de Kock, right? He's known as Prime Evil in South Africa. He was convicted for murdering countless people, leading, torturing countless people. Like, basically, he's not...
He ain't good.
He's terrible. They call him Prime Evil,
right.
So Prime Evil. This black psychologist, Pumla Godobo, I can never say her second last name. Forgive me, Pumla, you're a saint. She was intrigued by him. She was like, basically, during one of the trials, he wanted to apologize to the widows of two men that he killed. And in private. Mm-hmm. And so that, like, fascinated her. She was like, hmm. And so he did. And then she went and interviewed him. And they met for months. I don't remember if it's months or years, but I know for sure it was months. And, like, you know, talked. And she really got into, like, his mind. Now, if you see him, mind you, the actor who plays this guy is cute, right? When you look at the real guy, Google Eugene. That guy, he looks creepy. Like, he looks crazy. He's out of jail now. Eugene, don't come for me. Right. But he looks crazy. And so, like, he just looks, like, scary. But it was just very, it was something that was very sympathetic about his character. That was kind of like, you know, it was sad because the South African government created him mm-hmm. because he's technically a soldier and then convicted him. And like in the play, the way he words it, he was like, you know, he was like black South Africa needed someone held accountable and white South Africa needed a scapegoat. And wow. I was like, dang. And that's like the only bit of sympathy I had. And so basically these children, so that we, I'm trying to like put this in order. The kids today, I hosted a student matinee and they were like asking questions and they asked the actors, they were like, do you feel like these his character is redeemable? And surprisingly, the actor who played him said no. And I was like, whoa. Like, as a white man, I was like, right. Whoa. He was like, no, I don't think so. He's like, there's no way that all these atrocities that you've committed can just go away. Yes, right. People can change, but he was like, there's some things that are too far. And I wasn't surprised about his answer because I've talked to him before. And, like, I know that he's very black and white about things. Like, I told him straight to his face. I was like, honestly, I felt safer when I studied abroad in England because I knew if I got kidnapped there, people would care. And he was like, I'm so sorry that you feel that way. He's like, is that so true? Like, it's really messed up. And I was like, you better be woke.
Right.
So what's the scale? I say all that to say two things. Do you feel people can change? And what quantifies as woke for white people, in your opinion? Like, what would you be like, okay, you kind of woke, or are you?
There's always a side eye, you know?
There's always some shade. Yeah, I'm very shade. Like she said in her poem this weekend, do you know your history as well as you pretend to know mine? Girl, child, sister, honey, boo, boo, child.
Okay.
Snatched edges. I had a few people come to mind when I heard her say that.
My goodness. Yeah, she really. Her name was like Sunflower Mo. Yes. Yeah, shout out to you because she spoke the truth. I feel like it really depends. I feel like if you want to be forgiven and you show that you are turning over some new leaf or that you've learned something from what you've done, mm-hmm. then I feel like you can be redeemed in that sense, because who am I to, you know, judge you or condemn you for the things you've done? Because at the end of the day, sin is sin.
Mm-hmm.
If we're going straight by the book,
mm-hmm.
then sin is sin.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
whatever I've done is just as bad as you've done.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So in that sense, yeah, you can be redeemed. Even white people, I guess. But at the same time, there's you know, like, sorry. If they're fake, like, there's a difference between, like, really, like, being remorseful right. and, like, saving face, you know?
That's a good point, too. Like, you actually care, or are you apologizing? It's just one of those things with that situation that was like, okay, he can have changed or anything, but he's still living and knows all that people aren't. Like, that's the one right. thing about... There's something that's just about murder. That's just like...
It's like...
Ooh!
Yeah, like, because you didn't just affect that one person that you killed. You affected a whole family. You affected their livelihood. You, like, and I never thought of it in that concept.
You affected the future. You don't know what that
exactly.
person's purpose was.
Yeah, they could have
you
been
had no right to cut that short.
A millionaire that... save their entire family.
Yeah, like, you have like, no right to cut that short. Who are you?
It's just, that's the major issue I have with that, is that you don't know who they were going to be.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody knows who anybody's going to be. And you just snatch that away from them for what?
Because you felt some type of way.
Like, you know, And it's different when it's like your life or their life. I mean,
yeah, that's totally different.
You know, self-preservation is an innate thing. Like we do it, and I don't think anyone should feel bad about that if someone's trying to kill you. But it's still not something that you do just for shits and giggles. Like,
and that was one of those things where it was like, you know, watching the show, he was like, the way that people create fear is the system that created him. Like, these black South Africans are gonna do this, this, and this if we don't do this, this, and this. And it's just sad because, like, and granted, I haven't had the chance to read her book, but just seeing the show, he was like, you know, like, my colleagues got on that stand and sang like canaries as if they weren't right next to me. Like, and that's the part that's so crazy. That's the only, because honestly, I don't really feel bad for Bull, but I feel bad. I feel as though there's plenty of people who, walking around scot-free.
Held accountable.
Exactly. Like, and it goes back to how I feel about the whole Nate Parker, whatever his
Casey
name is.
Something, right?
Cassie? Affleck.
Yeah, Casey Affleck.
Yeah. We're either all or none. Like, that's not fair.
Exactly. And that's how that's why I didn't really feel bad for Nate Parker, because he didn't show that he felt bad about what he did. And it's pretty obvious that he did it. Like, if he had shown any remorse, people would have felt
more bad. And he tried with this very white man's response that you don't have the right to have my brother.
Right. Like
the courts found me not guilty. Who do you think you are? Because that doesn't work for you. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry, but I'm not sorry because I didn't create the system.
Do you have?
But who did you thought? You really thought you could do that, sir? Bruh. He tried. When I read that, I was like, no, he didn't. No, he didn't. Even now, even remembering it, I'm like, no, that's not what he said. Maybe I'm getting it wrong.
And apparently he like turned down Oprah's help to like redeem his
image?
Name. Yeah, like to like, you know, she was like, yeah, like, you know, we'll help you. Like, all you gotta do is apologize and explain this and, you know, do this and that. And he would just, what type of person?
It's weird. It's weird to me because I will say that when I know I'm not wrong, I'm not apologizing. So I'm just like, if you really feel that strongly, do you feel like you're admitting to something that you didn't do by apologizing? That's one of those things where I'm like, now I'm confused.
Right.
Because I know how I am. I'm not apologizing. If I didn't do anything, I'm not apologizing. Why would I lie? Like, why would I be like, oh, I apologize for what? I didn't do anything. What are you talking about? But he didn't say he didn't do anything. He said the court found me not guilty.
Right. There's a difference.
So that's the reason why I'm like, so did you do it or no? Because you have that much conviction that you don't feel like you need to apologize. So you better had not done it.
You don't feel like you need to explain yourself either. So like,
so you best not have done it. That's the thing. I'm like, that's when not having to explain yourself goes too far. You know how you always have to tell other people, like, you don't have to explain yourself. I have to tell myself that all the time. Bro, whoever told you that did a good job. But like, bro, you got to stop. You need to explain something. This is crazy. That's crazy.
Exactly.
That young lady took her life. That's crazy. There's no excuse. People are like, oh, well, there were other factors. Trauma is trauma is trauma. I don't care how many other factors she had. Trauma triggers things. Period. Period. What about woke white people?
Woke white people.
Because he's like real woke.
I mean, like,
he's also kind of fine, though. I'm not going to lie.
He told me today,
he's like, oh, I might tune in, so I don't know if you're listening, but.
Hey, daddy. Meanwhile,
I wonder if he knows.
Oh,
how blacky black. I wonder what the people who come here, because it's a vegan place, who are not black, how do they feel?
No, for real.
Because this place is so blackity black, y'all. Black, y'all.
Black.
And I'm black and I'm back. And so when I see like people who are not black in here, I'm like, how you feeling?
Is this okay? Are you okay?
Right, not that I care.
Right, because
when I walk into white spaces, y'all don't care if I'm okay. I just feel like black people are too accommodating.
Exactly.
Oh, other people do not accommodate us that much when we're in places.
Oh.
They'll be like, whereas we're like, oh, like if anything, you're more catered to because you're like, oh.
Right. welcome.
We're not even that nice to each other.
At all. Like, are you kidding me? So, up to that point, one of the our Black Book customers, shout out to Black and White Look on U Street, the eyeglass place, where I got my contacts, thank the Lord.
Oh, they say Blue Cross.
Oh, you know what? I don't know. She take a lot of insurance, though.
Okay, I'm about to hit her up. I'll make my appointment. Sorry.
But she get, like, frames for, like, $89.
Ooh, mm-hmm. Pretty good, pretty good.
But she started to do more marketing, and so she reached out to Comcast to, start, like, maybe, like, a little
commercial.
Yeah. So they come to her, and apparently Comcast, like, the way they do their market, like, research or whatever when they're starting to make a commercial, they come with, like, a booklet of, like, your business, and, like, they know all the stuff about you and all this. So oh, she was crazy. Telling me, like, yeah, she, like, came with this John, and I was like, oh, okay, like, this is cool. And so the woman, the representative, was Black, and she said to her, so I noticed on your website, like, you only have Black people, so do you only want to market to Black people? And she's saying this as a sister, like, just as, like, yeah. Is this a thing that you want to do?
Right.
And then I was sitting here, like...
And if I do, say let me stop.
What's wrong with that? Like, what's wrong with her only having Black models to model glasses when glasses are a universal thing? Like, everybody's blind out here.
Yeah, for real.
Not only Black people.
No, yeah, way more people wear contacts and glasses than you would think.
Like, are you kidding me?
I'm actually more surprised when people don't.
Exactly.
To be honest, I'm like, you don't wear anything? Nothing?
Right.
You just wake up and you see?
Right.
I used to wake up and see. I've known that life, but, like, at this point, I got 13 years without it.
You know?
12. Yeah.
I've worn glasses since I was 5. Oh. I don't even remember.
I wore glasses since I was 11. But I didn't actually start wearing them for real until I was in 8th grade. Like, I wasn't wearing my glasses.
Yeah.
That was crazy. I was like, no.
But I'm just like...
Yeah, I don't know why we... Even, like, she knows. I was irritated Saturday because I was like, can we just have anything?
Can we?
Sometimes you just... And I think it's weird. And even my being hesitant to say it just shows how condemned it is by society to desire a Black space. Because no one looks sideways at other people for wanting their own space. No one, for some reason, whenever we do it, it's a problem. I don't know why. And it's just like, but why? We let everybody in on everything all the time.
We do. Like, it's not like we're saying no whites allowed. Like, are you kidding me?
Right.
Get the hell out of here.
Even when I was leaving chapel brunch, I just saw these people who looked like they just got done working out. This white, I don't know if they were a couple, but they were a boy and a girl. And they just walk in casually by Blackburn. And I'm like, where y'all going?
Or like those white people who got caught on the yard trying to have a picnic.
Oh, I remember that. That made me mad. Like, this is a private university. And it's not even about you being white. It's about you being, it's a private university.
Like, do you
the
go
fact
here?
That you're, right, the fact that you're white and having a picnic as if this is a park is disrespectful. And if you can't see why it's disrespectful, one, if you're listening, you can't see why it's disrespectful, turn off the show. And second of all, and two, you would not do that anywhere else. That's the thing. Why must you try me?
Because people go on Harvard's campus and just have...
Right, like, I would never disrespect Boston University's campus. I could never go to Yale and have a picnic. They would be like, exit stage left.
Like, do you go here, miss? Where's your student ID?
Trifling. One of my favorite words in the English dictionary. That's love the word trifling.
Meanwhile, at my Black university... Did anybody come up to them? I'm sure they didn't.
Dang.
Because we probably were too nice. Oh. Let's just let them have their picnic. No!
Hey, look, like, we're too nice. Hi, I'm about to call campus. The only reason why I didn't go up to the people I saw is because they had kids with them. And that's just, that's not right. Yeah, yeah. Not that anyone cares when we have our kids with us.
Right, no. But.
Oh my gosh, I left out a significant part of my week. I'm going to be a godmom.
Yay!
I'm stressed. If you're listening, because she'd be listening. But I think she's at work tonight. She having twins. But I'm not going to be godmom to the twins. I'm godmom to one of the twins. I have one twin. Elise has the other twin. And then somebody has both the twins.
Oh,
There's gonna be multiple grandmas. And I'm planning a baby shower. So if you have any baby shower tips, feel free to email us at unapologeticqueens@gmail.com because I've been on Pinterest like.
Oh my God. Oh my, my friend. You know when Carmita had her baby. Mm-hmm. It was so cute. So the baby's names. I mean, the baby's name. She did it on these big blocks mm-hmm. of like. Like the play part. Yeah. Like, and it was so cute. Like, she decorated it and stuff. It took her forever, but she likes that.
She did it herself?
Yes.
She bold. That's great.
She's very.
I hate arts and crafts.
No, she's like the arts and crafts master.
Amen. I'm proud.
So she did the whole thing. It was so cute. It was so big. And like, it was taller than her, really. Like, it was great. I think that's cute.
That's so cute. All right. Well, Kalisa, see you. I don't know how to do arts and crafts. Kalisa's gonna be like, I don't know her. I don't know how to do arts and crafts. I know how to, like, decorate.
How do you feel about woke white people?
Woke white people? I feel like I'm just waiting for the day that your whiteness just
shows.
Gets out of, like, yeah. Like, I have a few people who I know who are like, who are very conscious, but here's the thing. I think the reason why I respect the actor in the show today so much is because he's black and white. Because he's like, no, this a spade is a spade is a spade is a spade. Like, stop trying to downplay what it is. It is what it is. And just because you're affected by what it is, or because you feel some type of way about the fact that it is, doesn't change the fact that it is. Period. And, like, even one of my, somebody who I work with who is dope, she's not from America. So her viewness of white America is very interesting. But even her whiteness shows. Like, we were talking about Hidden Figures. And she was like, I appreciated how, like, we were talking about the white savior moment in the movie that didn't even exist in real life. That didn't happen. And that was controversial. And she was like, but, you know, that moment gave the character the time, the opportunity to get angry. And usually when you see movies like this, women and, you know, like, people of color are never allowed to just, like, be angry. And I was like, so you mean this is a favor? It doesn't change?
Is the white savior moment when he, like, did the whole bathroom thing? Like, he made sure that
yes.
He,
okay. Why was that?
I was like, did this actually happen? Like, it just didn't seem like it happened.
It was so unnecessary.
Yeah.
It was so unnecessary. And then we say, oh, well, it gave her the opportunity to get angry. Why would I want to get angry about that? Why is that? Oh, yeah, we needed that. No, we didn't. No, we didn't. I see what you tried to do there, sis. We didn't need that. Thanks, though. Like, it's things like that where it's like, you cool. And I've always liked her from the time I met her. And I was just like, oh, I forget that you're still white.
Right.
Or, like, even, like, another person I know who dragged me to one of the women's, not the women's march, because I was not going, the Day Without a Woman, I texted in a group text that we had, and I was like, yo, does anybody know what they're doing about the girls that have been going missing in D.C.? Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh, yeah. She sent me, like, some of the information. So the way I started out, I did the funnel. I did the funnel, you know, upside down funnel approach. General question, detail, mm-hmm. detail. So I was like, who knows the leaders for the Women's March? Sent me their information. I'm like, okay, cool. I said, asking for a friend. Black people would have caught it. I'm just asking for a friend. For some reason, I don't know why we've added that shade to our repertoire of shade, but it's been added, and I appreciate everything about it. Newly added, but I appreciate everything about it. So I was like, oh, asking for a friend. Who's the leader of this? And then I asked something else. And I was like, oh, okay. Also asking for a friend. What have they said about the girls going missing in D.C.? And it's like, oh, I'm sure they're doing something. That was my question. What have they said?
What are the receipts?
And it was just like, oh, something. It was just like very, just excuses.
And I've heard anything.
And as someone who's so sisterhood, so pro-woman, so I want to hear about the black experience, I'm wearing a Black Lives Matter button type thing, like that person, it was kind of like, it just shows itself all the time. Even a white girl I know who was like, please tell me if I ever do anything that's like considered like microaggressive, still pulled some white girl shit. So I'm just like, you know what?
You know, Jess has yet to pull a white girl shit. I'm very proud of her.
Give her some time. I'm joking. Let me stop. That's so shady. I'm joking.
She's like
premier white morsel. Yeah. Like premier. That's how, like, I feel about this one bull, but we only have two interactions, so I'm not sure. A1. And so what do you think about woke black people who date white people?
It's an interesting thing. I feel like it's so common now. Like,
really?
Yeah, and like my grandma always said this. She was like, because my dad has like a light skin thing. Like, mm-hmm. it's obvious. And now he's with a white woman, so.
Yikes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So she was like, yeah, like, you know, back in the 60s and 70s, all these woke brothers was out here like being woke. But they all had a white woman.
Yeah. My mama always says that. Preaching black, but sleeping white. And I'll be like, what's the problem with that? Like, when I was younger, me now, I'm kind of like, I kind of see where you're coming from.
Right.
But
it's like, could you not find a sister? Or like, were you even looking for a sister? I know sisters was throwing themselves at you.
It's,
you know,
interesting, because immediately when we think preaching black, sleeping white, or even dating outside of your race, we automatically think men, as if black women didn't do it too. Maya Angelou is the definition middle namesake of black girl magic. Definitely married some Greek man who gave her that last name. Damn. I was all up in her bio. Because I wanted to understand why my mom felt the need to give me something that was up, like, why that was my name. So I just wanted to know why. So I was like, So I was like, what about? And I started naming. Who else did I name?
Cheska Lee. Like, she's with, you know, the influencer. She actually, she works on MTV. And she, like, does these little, like, race tutorial videos, low-key, like, like, basically, like, race for dummies, like, type stuff. So, like, what's institutional racism? Like, stuff like that. So, like, she breaks it down so that white people are like, oh, my God. Mind you, she has a white husband.
It's just interesting, because I'm just always like, I always wonder the thought process of when, as someone who's now, okay, disclaimer, Tylea has dated every guy. Except for Native American. Find him, I'll probably date him too. But I'm joking.
I think I've kissed every guy, but not dated. Like, I've never, no white dude has ever wanted to date me like that.
Not even like a school dance?
I mean, yeah, no. I was always,
I've kissed, like, every guy too.
Yeah, like, you know, it's like, okay, we made out, that's it,
bye. Yeah, I want to say, okay, I didn't go on a date with an Asian guy, but that was my first dance in 8th grade, and I made out. Shout out to you, Bevon. I know he's not watching, he's probably going to be like, tell you.
Made out with an Asian
guy?
No.
Yeah, my first dance was with a boy who was Filipino, his name was Rafi. Who turned out to be one of my closest friends' first kiss, which I did not know until we were in, like, high school. I did not know that because we weren't close in 8th grade. Like, yeah, we taking it back, y'all. Like, right. Most people are like, well, you don't count. We just talking about this for the sake of talking about it, okay?
Right.
And then, yeah, the Asian boy I kissed was Cambodian. But I don't know. Sometimes I don't know if he count, because low-key, he's, like, a shade darker than me.
No, that's what I'm saying. I had a crush on, like, a couple Filipinos that they were way darker than me. Like, they the blacks or the Asians, you know? Like, they don't necessarily claim Filipinos as Asian. That's true.
Pacific Islanders. Boom. It's trifling how, like, the U.S. is, like, Asian / Pacific Islander. Like, come on, put some respect on my culture.
Right.
Like, but yeah, my guess is up to the individual. But, like, I think in my recent evolution, you know, honestly, I will say, in my evolution of realizing how beautiful and dope black women are, more guys of other races were always attracted to me even more. And it was interesting. It was very interesting. And also, when I, like, was in Europe, like, they don't care about, I mean, they care about race. Like, we will never flex. They care about, they are racist in Europe. Like, we got to remember, because a lot of people, a lot of Black Americans, like, kind of idolize Europe and like, oh, well, no, like, everyone, you know, during certain periods of times when, you know, Black entertainers couldn't get work, they would go to France. Truth.
That's true.
Lest we forget how many places were colonized by France. Like, we're not going to act like they're not racist. Like, we can't act like Spain, France, Portugal. All of y'all were wrong. All of y'all were wrong.
All of them.
But
that's what European history is.
The right.
Colonization Terror. Of the world. Like, get the hell out of here.
Terror. It was really funny. So today, the reason I started laughing when you were talking is because today I was texting my line sister. Shout out to my inverse. And she, we were texting about, like, she was struggling with something. And I was like, we were, like, talking about the enemy. We were like, oh, man. I was like, the enemy's so petty. And then she was like, why is there this Black guy with a dashiki print book bag or something? I forget what she said. She said somebody was wearing something. He was either wearing a dashiki, because dashiki is not a print, wearing a dashiki or had some kente. He had a kente cloth. Yeah, he had a kente book bag, right? And then I was like, I sent her like the eye roll emoji, and then she was like, because he came. I was like, why would he wear that? And she was like, because he came to steal, kill, and destroy, right? And he was talking. She was like answering the first question. I was like, dang, you feel that strongly about white people? And she's like, wait, what? And like, we got so confused. And then she was like, I mean, it's not too far off. And I was like, dang, if the shoe fits.
It was a white dude wearing this kente?
Yeah, but back. She was back. She was at her, at her school, Donald Trump's her commencement speaker. She goes to school in Lynchburg, Virginia. I was like, are you surprised?
Well, right.
I was like, are we
welcome,
shocked?
No.
Are we shocked?
Not even a little bit.
I love you though, Lon. But I was just like, dang.
Cold world.
No blanket. But yeah, I think that's one thing for some reason. And also, have you noticed, like, we always also say, me and Jasmine, oh, you weren't with us. Me and Jasmine, Lil Jasmine Woods, we kept asking ourselves, were we Black enough to date, like, a white guy? Have you noticed, white guys love Black, dark,
black,
beautiful,
black,
like,
gorgeous queens from the Nile.
No, like, for real, like, Nubian princess. I'm made of shea butter and chocolate. Like, me, we're really like, are we Black enough? Like, am I Black enough to date you? At least here in America. We ask ourselves.
That's real.
I was like, is my name even Black enough? Look, what is it? That one guy, he's like a prince or something. He's like a millionaire. And it was like, and then Princess Angela Brown. Is my name Black enough to date you? Like, I don't know.
That's real. I saw, I think he was white. I'm pretty sure he was white. But he was walking in my hood, so then, you know, I was like, I don't know.
Right.
And he looked like he lived in the hood.
Yeah.
Like, so he had, like, a little scarf on his head and shit, and he was rocking around with the hat, but the scarf was all the way down. And I was just like, okay. And he's
walking by me. It's 2006, huh?
Right. And he's walking by me. He's like, oh, sister, I love your locks. I love your locks. Your locks are beautiful. And then he looked at my ear. Oh, he said, your earrings, too. You're just so Afrocentric, girl. I love it. Just keep being beautiful and Black. I was just like, oh, you know, thank you.
Yeah. Here for it.
Thanks. But I was just like, you about white shit.
It's so interesting. It's like, am I Black? Like, literally, am I Black enough for you? I don't know. Especially, literally, because we were, I forget who I was talking about. Oh, talking to. But that was something that we noticed in America. Like, white guys either date girls who are racially ambiguous / mixed, or they're super Black.
There's
never been an in-between. I mean, I've dated, Jewish guys and Italian guys. But, like, I mean, they tend to, like, date Black women anyway. So it's like, that's not really...
It's not too far off.
Yeah, it's not too far off.
But, and then there'll be the brothers that come out talking about, like, when I was waiting for you at the Metro... This dude comes up to me with his oils, and I was like, oh, God. I'm like, you know, I already got my smell good. It's okay. Like, shit. And then he was like, yeah, you know, like, I like light-skinned females. And and I was just like, why don't you like dark-skinned females? Why don't you like medium-skinned females? Like, I don't understand. And he was like, well, everybody got preference. And he's like, what's your preference? I'm sure you like light-skinned dudes. I was like, why would you just assume that I like light-skinned dudes? Like,
my mom said as a dark-skinned woman, she's always been treated the best by light-skinned dudes. It's very interesting. And then I forget which one of my, she said around her friend, she was like, so if someone who's in between, you just get treated great by both, huh? And I was like, Swerve.
This is the paradox that we live in.
I just think it's all funny. I think it's all hilarious if everyone still subscribes to this foolishness. And it's just so funny because subconsciously, I don't think people even realize that subconsciously they subscribe to it too. Everybody. I don't give a damn how woke you thought you are or anything. Anything. I remember in high school, one of my friends, he's my friend now, he wanted to date me and he was like real chocolate, real dark skin. And I was just like, this is like freshman year. And I was like, I can't date him because he's too dark. And my poor, poor children. Like, that's trifling. But it's because society, this is my 14-year-old mind.
Right.
Or even, like...
That's how it be, though. Oh, my God.
Even girls who subconsciously may think that they're better than girls because they're light-skinned. Like, that's things like that. Or people who are subconsciously insecure because they... Like, there's just so many ways. Or that is your security. Because that's also a form of, like, slave mentality. All of it's slave mentality. Yeah, it is. And, like, honestly, it's interesting because, like, we all... Don't got the sauce.
We don't.
Unless, right now, who's winning? Or who's considered the most beautiful girls who are mixed / racially ambiguous. That's what you see on TV. So I don't even know why this light skin, dark skin thing is even a debate. Because it actually doesn't matter right now when it comes to societal standards and what we define as beauty. Because nobody's a participant in this right now.
Yeah, literally.
No matter what you thought, like shit. So.
It doesn't make any difference at all.
It doesn't matter.
But, you know, we're actually out of time.
We are.
Even though... This tablet doesn't necessarily want us to be on the top.
Yeah, the tablet doesn't seem to care.
So, I'm just going to shut it off and see what happens.
Oh.
So, until next week, guys.
Until next time.